question. What is sympathy and what is empathy? Anything you want to throw out? When have you been, yeah.
Well, sympathy is understanding someone else's problems, having feeling for them. Empathy is the next step of being, so to speak, walking in their shoes and being able to support them and help them along the way, I guess.
Yeah, so I heard you say sympathy is understanding.
Yeah, understanding.
And feeling for. And empathy is?
Empathy is action or actually taking steps to help relieve the problem of that the sympathy is about, I guess.
Taking a response.
A response, yeah.
Good.
Feeling with?
Other?
Kind of like instead of feeling for, kind of feeling with, like.
Okay,
in your shoes.
Yeah, I'm hearing, yeah, and Johnny mentioned that too. Yeah. So there's a sense of being in their shoes,
yeah.
And I heard feeling with, whereas this might be more feeling for, and this is feeling with. And I mentioned that last week to promote this forum.
Well, it really touches your heart, that empathy just gets in there.
Empathy touches your heart.
Deeper than sympathy.
Whose heart, by the way, the giver or the receiver?
Both, hopefully.
Yeah. You almost are called to do something like you cannot not help them empathy.
So from the giver's perspective, your heart is being touched. That moves you. Yeah. To both, probably both, right?
Mm-hmm.
How about from the receiver's perspective, and their heart? Is it different on these two?
Yeah, I would think so. I think in some cases, people are in a situation, people can be sympathetic but not do anything. It's like, well, it's nice that you think my lot is bad, but that's not helping right now. Whereas if somebody's empathetic, they feel like they're at least trying to do something, trying to help, whether it's just,
So it kind of gets to this idea. As the receiver, can you receive sympathy and not even know it? Meaning, can someone sympathize for you from afar and you never even know?
Yeah, yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yes.
And I'm starting to hear with empathy, if as the receiver, there's more likely an awareness that someone is empathizing with you. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, sharing the burden, so to speak. There's a connection, emotional connection between the two.
Mm-hmm.
When I see the S, I think of sorry. So I'm sorry for versus feeling for. That's what I think of.
Sorry for
versus feeling for.
Feeling for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good. Are we aware in our day-to-day interactions with our spouse, with our friends, with a neighbor, with our coworker? Are we aware of moments where we're expressing sympathy or empathy? Or does it all just sort of happen really fast? And
it depends. I mean, I think
for
yeah.
I think there are other times when we sit around the dinner table or something and we think of some situation and boy, it's just really sad. We feel bad for that. And
mm-hmm.
So we're expressing sympathy because we're not doing anything except sitting around saying we ought to do something but not sure what.
Do we do a bit more of this than that?
Mm-hmm.
So,
it's just simple.
Is one easier than the other? Does one require less of you? Maybe?
Yeah, one requires less.
As my job as a chaplain, when I'm working with retired clergy, sympathy I see is the time when I send a card.
Mm.
Empathy is when I make the phone call.
Okay. Ooh.
And say,
good idea.
Good.
Can I meet with you? Can we talk about?
So this is sending a card, and this is
being present
somehow, whether it's on the phone or in person. That's being with versus feeling for. Yeah.
My cousin is she lives in Michigan and she's just going into some serious chemotherapy and stuff for cancer. And I offered her the quilt. I said, let me send you a quilt. She said, no, no, no. She said, I know you're praying for me, and I know you support me. I don't need a tangible something.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, just keep checking in on me.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, that sort of, my first response is, what can I do for you? Let me send you a quilt. Well,
mm-hmm.
I'm not making the quilt. I'm
yeah.
simply sending it.
Yeah, so a quilt, a card. And she says, well, you know, I don't really need the quilt. I don't need the outward invisible sign. I'd rather have, just keep checking in on me.
Yeah.
I actually would prefer connection.
Yeah,
that's a great example. Does anyone know how to turn off that heater? I bet we could probably.
Go for it.
Oh, are we good? Karen, how are you feeling?
He's good.
Nice and toasty.
I can turn it off.
About the fire is coming.
Yeah.
Bad jokes are. Okay, good. So that was good. So I throw this a couple things. We've named a lot of these. You know, maybe a goal of sympathy might be understanding and caring for someone, and in empathy, maybe it's more about sharing feelings, feeling the feelings of the other, feeling their feelings, not just sharing feelings, but feeling feelings. A focus, you know, feeling or expressing pity or sorrow for someone, that you guys named that, and solutions or assistance. You know, that one probably bridges. That one may be a more of a gray area. In empathy, which you just named, emotional connection, be with. I just need someone to be with me. That's a classic request for empathy. And then the classic metaphor is, sympathy is when you throw someone a rope. Empathy is when you get into the hole with them. Have you ever heard that or something like that? Yeah. So this business of solutions or helping, assistance, that one's maybe has elements of both. You know, maybe the line isn't real clear all the time. Why as Christians, why are we interested in empathy? Is this Oprah Super Soul Sunday? Or is there something unique about Jesus's way?
Yeah.
That we follow, that empathy has something to say to us. Anything come to mind? How about the great commandment?
Yeah,
we're supposed to care for the poor and care for the needy, the disabled, the widow, the orphans.
Care for others, right? Which you know, again, well, let's test the boundary there. You can care for someone that maybe not empathize with them. So that's something to check in on as we go through this. And that goes to that assistance, that help thing. So look at the great commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. So there seems to be a kind of, embedded in that statement, an idea of be in their shoes in some way. Don't just love them. Love them as yourself. Relate to them. There's a relationality. And so in the some of the letters from Paul and some of the letters maybe not from Paul, there's this call to the early Christian communities that have elements of empathy. Bear one another's burdens. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. You know, be with. And then I think really it comes through in Hebrews, which was brought out in the forum last week when Matthew, who was homeless, basically took this passage from the letter to the Hebrews, or rather maybe it wasn't even a letter, maybe it was more of a sermon, but remember those who are in prison as though you were in prison with them. That's empathy. That's empathy, isn't it? Don't just remember them, but remember them in a way that as if you were with them. That changes things a little bit. Same with those who are being tortured, as though you yourselves were being tortured. So it's a recall to stand in their shoes. Right. So that's very much empathy. And then so Matthew last week said, you know, remember the homeless as if you yourself were homeless. How does that change things when we try to put ourselves in the shoes of the other? So I'm going to show this clip from, does anybody know who Brene Brown is? She did a really, she's done a couple of, she's a vulnerability sort of researcher. She did a TED Talk a few years ago that went really viral on vulnerability. Anyway, she includes in her talks, because it's all wrapped up, is empathy is part of vulnerability conversation. And so somebody put it to a kind of a cute cartoon. So. See if you notice anything here that we haven't already mentioned.
So what is empathy, and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar who studied professions, very diverse professions, where empathy is relevant, and came up with four qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think that empathy is this kind of sacred space when someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, I'm down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, woo! It's bad, uh-huh? No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with at least. And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. Oh, at least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, I don't even know what to say right now, I'm just so glad you told me. Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
Huh. Okay. Yeah. Anything there that struck you?
Connections.
This is what I really took from that. This is why I think it's an important topic for Christians. Empathy fuels connection, fuels relationship. Sympathy, in her words, drives disconnection.
That's an interesting sentence.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We don't see that.
Mm.
I mean,
but I'm not saying you need to agree with it, by the way.
No. But I think that's a sometimes very interesting comment. That's something to think about.
Mm-hmm. Or it enables continued disconnection. When you feel sorry for someone, you can kind of do that from a safe distance.
Right,
as
exactly.
In the video.
Yeah.
And you don't have to get your hands dirty. You don't have to put your own emotion and vulnerability at stake. You can kind of do it from afar. You can offer them a sandwich.
Mm-hmm. Well, but at the end, I like the way that it gives you permission to say, oh my gosh, I just don't even know what to say right now.
Yeah.
But that's okay. That's an empathetic response.
Because
a lot of times you know you'll get into an awkward situation and people will try to do that silver lining because they don't know what to say. But it's okay
right.
if you don't know what to say.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe if you're not really sure what to say, just listen and don't say anything.
Mm-hmm.
What if you are sure what to say? Let's say someone shares with you a problem, and you know the
you
exact
know that
solution for them.
Well, they have to come to that themselves a lot of times. You can't just tell someone what they should do. Right?
Maybe.
Or you could say it and say, this is just something to think about. Have you thought about this?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of saying, this is what you should do. Have you thought about it?
Have you ever had a situation with a spouse or a friend or, you know, family member, and they share what's on their mind, and you're like, honey, what you need to do is just blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And I know I'm right about that solution. I've helped other people do it too. But is there communication to me about that problem a request for a solution necessarily?
No.
No.
Most of the time, most of the time not.
Yeah.
I'm experiencing.
Most of the time not.
I'm experiencing
well,
that with my 22-year-old.
I know what to do. I just want you to listen.
Yes. In fact, have you been told that? I know the solution. Hello. I just need you to listen to me. It kind of breaks the magic, though, doesn't it? When you have to like walk someone through it. It's hard to be big with when you're being forced to and walk through it, but yeah, I think that's a big piece of it. It's that I think we do have a natural desire. It's awkward, you know. Someone's pouring out their feelings and crying, maybe, and there's a natural desire. I think an innate desire to want to
solve the problem,
fix.
Chris, go ahead.
Yeah.
I was thinking, rather than you should, maybe say, have you considered?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I still think sometimes they just don't want that. I mean, I have a 22-year-old son, and it's like, look, I just want you to, he said this more than once, I just want you to listen to me. I don't want you, if I want advice, I'll ask you for it.
Yeah.
Right.
But I just want you to listen to me. I don't want you to give me advice.
Yeah.
I just want you to listen to me and give me a hug.
Mm-hmm.
And don't even say it's going to be all right.
Yeah.
You know, just listen to me. Don't say anything unless I ask.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes it doesn't honor them to provide the solution. It's kind of like, well, I know you'll figure it out. I know you'll, you know, find your way through to
right,
the
exactly.
answer, or you'll do what you need to do.
Yeah.
But I was going to ask, like, it's hard, like right now I have a situation, and it's hard to have empathy when the person denies that they're suffering and doesn't include won't share.
Won't,
because then I go right into sympathy, like, too bad for you, I'm moving on.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a challenge, isn't it? When you know someone's suffering, but yet they can't, they're disconnected from their own suffering such that they can't really articulate it or talk to or open up about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can we still be empathetic with somebody like that?
Sometimes I think if you say, if I was in your shoes, this is maybe the way I would work, but I'm not in your shoes, therefore, you know. So you're giving them a little bit of direction,
mm-hmm.
but you're letting them make a choice.
A softer way
yeah.
of providing solutions and fixing.
I think sometimes if someone can't share, just being in their present and saying, you know, I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
If you need a friend,
mm-hmm.
I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know something's going on. I'm not going to pry, but be assured I'm there to listen. Or?
Yeah. I think those are good. Yeah. So the idea is, even with somebody who is not going to share with us, yet we're emotionally aware enough to sort of notice, we can still do things to be with. And we don't need to pry it out of them necessarily, do we?
No.
Or you can just sort of sense and feel.
Yeah.
My husband's family is the sort of a traditional Chinese where, I mean, there was very little emotional connection. And I remember when his dad came down with pneumonia and 2 weeks later was gone, there was one point at which, you know, I could just read on the face of his older brother, I want a hug, I can't. I mean, they didn't know how, they still don't know how to ask for that. So at some point, I just was finally looked at him and I was like, I just reached out and hugged him. I didn't say a word, but I reached out and hugged him because that's what he really wanted to ask me for. He just didn't know how to ask me. And so sometimes trying to be aware enough to read that type of sort of like what you know they're really wanting, just don't know how to ask for, just give it to them.
Yeah, so it takes a bit of emotional awareness on our parts to notice that in others. So we have to be kind of on alert, emotionally on alert, right? And be maybe aware of their style, their cultural background, the way they were raised, whatever it happens
right.
to be. And be willing, I think, I've heard a couple times now, sometimes you don't need any words at all. Sometimes a hug. I heard, we have this ministry where people come by and bring you food when you're in the hospital or just getting back from the hospital or something like that. It's like a card or something, but when you show up, there's something more intimate about that, and you know, it's the gesture says more words than any words might have. Yeah, don't ruin this moment with words.
Yeah.
What are some of the barriers we have to practicing empathy then?
Well, being uncomfortable.
Being uncomfortable with silence?
Being uncomfortable with not being able to solve their problem.
Being uncomfortable with not being able to be a fixer or solve, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Busy schedules.
Being busy.
I'm too busy to get involved.
Yeah.
Just not having been in that situation before.
Mm.
Sometimes it's hard to understand.
Yeah, you can only go so far if their experience is so outside of your own. It can be hard to really, you have to really extrapolate your own life experience, right? I've never lost a child, but I have lost a job. And so I can relate to a sense of loss of identity.
Right.
Who am I? I mean, no, it's not clearly not the same, but it helps you get into that space a little bit, right?
There's fear of rejection.
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah, that's a good one. Yeah, what? Why are we worried about that?
Because we're afraid of being hurt too.
Yeah, so this is vulnerability, right?
Yeah.
So when you're going to be sympathetic, you know, we sign cards for folks, put them in the mail, boom. I was thoughtful. It means something. It's not an empty gesture. And I'm not here to beat up on sympathy. But there's a vulnerability then when you show up, and then try to really listen. And has anyone ever had somebody close the door on your face metaphorically when you tried to be there for someone?
Yes.
Yeah. And you kind of suffer in silence in those moments, don't you? You don't get to go to complain to somebody. I went to somebody who's grieving the loss of their husband and they didn't want to talk to me. Now I'm hurt. Who's here for me? You know, right?
Get over yourself.
She's got bigger problems than you. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so it's a little bit of, we're not going to get a lot of sympathy in that moment, so we have to be strong.
Well, I think at that point, that's more that your ego.
Yeah.
Because that's about them, that's not about you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and once you get to where you get, take the lack of them connecting with you personally, that's your ego getting in the way.
And we can operate in sympathy out of our own ego.
Absolutely.
Quite easily. We don't have to let go of that at all.
Right.
Yeah, but when we get into sympathy now, suddenly...
I mean, empathy, yeah.
It can't be about us anymore. Or it won't work.
I think we also just reflexively have an aversion to feeling pain. And so it's easier to be in the position of sympathy. Like, you know, that's not happening to me. Like, and then to feel someone's pain, sometimes it's like you're afraid you're going to get stuck in their morass.
Mm-hmm.
you know, because you really, you have to be willing to go there and touch that.
Well, yeah, if you'll talk to people that are super empathetic, they'll, that's the one difficulty in sometimes being so empathetic, is that you actually, I have my old, one of my older sisters feels like, you have to figure out ways to then be able to come out of that or cut those off at the point that you need to for your own well-being.
Therapists are just now beginning to really appreciate the trauma that they receive when listening to and empathizing with trauma in their
and they have to
patients.
Have ways to disconnect themselves from that once they're no longer needing to be with that person. Or else they can't, then their whole life gets.
Would it be a lovely world if we all had that problem? We're all going around empathizing so much. I need to go to my weekly empathic support group.
Some of us, though, I know, you know, we're taught to give. And sometimes you experience, I have been with people that I have a connection with that does not share with me until it's too late. And I have a regret. Where did I miss the signs? I, for example, I was religious education director at one of our previous churches, and one of my Sunday school teachers, and we met every month together to plan and pray and to read the Bible and prepare the lessons for the month. And this woman, I got a call from the priest, and he said, go to Jeannie's house. Her husband has committed suicide. So I go, well, I found out from her, I totally missed all of these signs that she was in distress. This man was an alcoholic. He had threatened to burn the house down. She and the kids had been in the car running from him. And all this, had no idea. And to go into that situation and hear all this, I just, yes, I was there and made a connection, but it was like, where was I that I totally missed this all these months?
I don't know. I think there's some people who are really good at hiding.
Obviously this had been a long-term thing, and she, but it was just amazing. I thought, boy, I don't know people.
Right.
You know, you just don't know what shoes are walking in.
We're very good at putting on a good show, aren't we? Man, I come across it on Facebook all the time. You know, you come across somebody who's really having a tough time, they share with you. Yet I'm familiar with their Facebook page, and you would never in a million years guess. I mean, that basic thing. So here are some of the ones I thought of. I think we mentioned cultural expectations to problem solve. Do we have that, you think?
Yes, we do.
We reward problem solvers and fixers, right? Don't we? As a lawyer, that was my job. I was paid to fix people's problems, not to empathize with them. And I think we noticed that you kind of mentioned that one. We don't notice. Either they're really good at hiding, or we're too wrapped up in our own stuff. Don't take the time. It's hard. I think, do we all know at some level doing empathy is hard and time consuming? You really have to focus, put down whatever plans you had for the next 2 hours.
Yeah.
Or longer. It's not a quick fix.
It's not a quick fix. Right. This could be a weekly get together now. Gosh, did I ask for this? I just wanted to offer this person a little sympathy. I don't want a friend. I think someone mentioned this one too, the avoidance of our own. Because you saw that in the clip, right? That to connect with somebody, you have to connect with your own feelings in some way. You have to connect with your own. Even if you haven't shared those feelings exactly, you have to find those feelings within yourself to connect with them. And a lot of us just don't want to do that. I guess that goes back to being hard work. No reward. We kind of mentioned that one. Well, not a lot of sympathy if you get the door closed in your face.
Right.
But it's also, it's not something that people really know about. There's no ego gratification exteriorly, right? And I just, so here are some examples of, you know, we do lots of these kinds of drives, right? Collecting backpacks.
But we don't really know. We don't know
who's picking them up.
Yeah.
No.
It's like it would be much harder to.
Well, and I think in some situations that's how it's meant to be, because you don't want to make them feel.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Sometimes they might. Yeah, they might not want to feel singled out.
Yeah. So, but using this as an example, right? Maybe a sympathy kind of response,
mm-hmm.
right? Your people in need, you're sending them a something of what they need, whether it's shoes, clothing, food. That's a sympathetic response, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a bad thing,
mm-hmm.
right? It's a very blessed thing particularly for the recipient. But it's easier to do, isn't it?
Yeah, and it has a level of indirection.
Totally,
you're not
indirect.
You're not connecting with the person who got your basket.
And you're not even meeting them.
Yeah,
exactly. You're much less having to listen to them.
Yeah.
Much less having to find in your life a connection with theirs.
Yeah.
Right. It's so way, way beyond.
Yeah.
What else? Someone said something about that. There's a role for that, though, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you would make them feel worse if they felt like you were just giving it to them out of pity. It's better if there is that disconnect sometimes, not always, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So right, it's a little bit forward to show up on someone's house and say, you know, the neighbors, we all took up this collection for you because we know you're down on your luck. Could that be forward? That could be
really forward.
It could be a bad outcome, even though it's well intended.
Yeah.
However, though, but it's a hard thing to figure out, isn't it? Because think about these fires.
Mm-hmm.
I put a post like this on Facebook that said something that I've noticed over the years: disasters somehow give us permission to be forward.
Yeah.
Don't they?
Mm-hmm.
We can now show up on that stranger's house and say, "I know you live alone. Are you aware of the warnings? You know, do you have a place to go?" And whatever. Yeah.
I thought it was interesting. I heard something about how the Del Mar Fairgrounds got too many apples and carrots, and they were basically going to rot.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't deal with all of them. And they said, what we really need is stuff in 2 weeks. What we need is stuff in 3 weeks. And that never happens because the mood has passed.
Right.
Yeah. Which, right,
we're
exactly.
We're gratifying ourselves when we drop off those apples.
Right. So we have to always challenge ourselves around sympathy responses. How much of that is about ourselves? Are we going to get our picture in the paper? Are we going to be able to put it up on the website? Are we going to be able to announce it at the annual meeting? We collected a zillion backpacks. Congratulations to us. So we just have to be mindful of that. So what happens next? It goes back to last week's form, right?
Mm-hmm.
Matthew said, the cathedral in Boston had a very sympathetic response to the homeless people in the park. They put an altar on wheels and wheeled it out to the park and did a Eucharist for them every Sunday. How beautiful, how blessed, how lovely, right? What a lovely thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, I don't know this for sure, but I can almost guarantee you, the Episcopal News Service did a blog about it. You know, there was probably on the news, right?
Yeah.
It was all this stuff, I have no doubt, right? But that got a little bit of splash. And everybody at the cathedral felt good about themselves, this ministry they were doing, I'm sure. Because you do. It makes you feel good. And then over time, some of those homeless folks who were going to that mass eventually said, you know, we couldn't help but notice, every night you wheel that altar back into the church and lock it up, safe and secure, safe from the elements, safe from the weather, safe from vandals. You know, what about us? What about us? And so they were kind of going deeper in that initial sympathetic response. They're kind of going, what about us? Can you have an empathetic response to us?
Chris,
yes.
There's a book out I noticed. It's kind of interesting. There is an organization called Beach Corps, and it is very much basing its whole mission on this book that's called Toxic Charity.
Toxic Charity, yeah. Everybody reads that in the seminar.
Toxic Charity. So, yes, because it's the old Albert Schweitzer. You don't, if somebody's hungry, you give him a fish, but you also teach him how to fish. And so much of what we do is throwing the backpack at people, but we're not going and saying, can we help you? What are your real needs so that we can, as a group, help you get those solved and things like that. So what we're doing is, as long as we keep giving, 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 people become takers, takers, takers.
Mm-hmm.
There's not that growing of the person to be
right.
What they really need
right.
Or want or should go back into society.
But there's that third element that we've talked about before, which is what are the
barriers? What would be the third element? Teach them give them a fish or teach them the fish?
And then what are the barriers that kept them from doing it?
What are the systemic barriers
yeah.
to the pond
mm-hmm.
to start with for that person?
Right.
And then I would almost add a fourth one, and that is, as Christians, remember, blessed are the poor.
They'll be with us.
Well, blessed are the poor. The poor have something to show us about God, mm-hmm. too.
Oh, yeah.
We have to go into this mutual. It's not about us giving to you poor people
yeah.
down there. And we're going to show you how to do it. Trust me, I know how it works. And we're going to teach you how to fish. I'm going to fix society so that you can get to the pond. It's about getting down into the hole with them and
mm-hmm.
saying, what do you have to show me about God that I'm missing?
Yeah.
Blessed are the poor. They know something about God that we don't. The privileged are going to have a harder time going through the eye of that needle, remember? There's a reason for that. And so we have to be also careful, I think. Sympathetic responses are a wonderful place to start. They're not always where we want to end, I think is how I kind of approach it. That we want to look for opportunities for occasions where we can go deeper in the relationship and then go so deep that it then becomes mutual. It's not just us, it's not service giver and service recipient.
Well, yeah. Like Interfaith, you can give to Interfaith, but Interfaith as an organization, they are training youth to work on computers. They are working with the veterans. They are doing so much
mm-hmm.
widely that, you know, what we do is the tip of the iceberg.
Mm-hmm.
It is just amazing what these organizations
yeah.
can do that we should be a part of rather than just bringing the turkeys.
Yeah, and that's a good conversation for the outreach ministry to say, what is really our role in doing these? Are we trying to do a kind of lightweight community service organization ministry? Is that what we're doing? It's just kind of a thin version of that? Or are we in this business for something different? And I think, again, you will know them by how they love. I think we're called. That's why I think we got to be. I think drives are wonderful. I know we do some lovely things, and we help people a lot. I think we could, for every one of those we do, we ought to do something though that also practices empathy. So for every child that we do an angel tree for, let's also call folks equally to think about, I don't know, tutoring ministry or something like that. Because. The Rotary Clubs, the schools, right? Those guys all do the drives. How are we different than that? Are we called to do something more? Are we called to stand out? Are people taking notice going, wow, St. Bart's, you guys, I've never heard of anyone doing that before. Those are the words we want to be said about Christians. You will know them by how they love. They're going to be different. The early Christian community stood out because they cared for the widows, right? Nobody else did. The widows were thrown out. They're nameless, faceless ex-people. So do you see what I'm saying about that? So you know, it's a both and, but I think we have to be mindful that the sympathetic response is the easy one. Mm-hmm. And we can lose sight of the idea that we're called to this other work as well.
Well, I think that if you provide those opportunities through the church, I think people would
mm-hmm.
do that more serious work and not just, you know, I mean, if you're going to organize the backpack thing, then people are going to participate in that. If you're going to organize a thing where you go feed the homeless, then people are going to do that.
That's right. That's
you know,
so it's a leadership.
It's a lot of it is, yeah, is what's put in front of us.
That's right.
And there's safety in numbers, in a sense.
Safety in numbers. So here's a good example of something coming up out in the courtyard right now. We're going to invite you to consider signing up to help out with the homeless rotational shelter, right? Where we have folks sleeping in this room
mm-hmm.
For
in
a few weeks.
In this
yeah.
in that.
So there's different ways you can participate in that. A sympathetic response, you can make a meal and drop it off. That's lovely. Beautiful offering. Or you can actually do what Maria, our witness a few months ago, said was so different about St. Bart's. You can sit at the table with them and eat alongside. That would be more of a, that now you're moving to empathy, right?
I've done that the last couple of years with my girls. It's, I think it's a really good experience. It's a little bit awkward though.
Awkward? Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think we live in, you have to enter into that awkwardness,
uh-huh.
right? That's where we find God. God's not going to be found at Costco picking up an extra giant bag of socks on the sock drive, most likely. But it's going to be in that awkward moment where we sit down with somebody who's going through a tough point in life, and how do I relate to this person in a way that doesn't seem awkward, you know, where I'm talking down to them and all that, right? And that's what Maria said in her witness, right? Do you guys remember her?
Mm-hmm.
She said, you guys talked to me and treated me like a person, you know? And so much that she decided to call St. Bart's when she got an apartment available. She just didn't have the deposit and that stuff. But she felt she had enough relationship with us because somebody had done that empathy work at the table with her, that she had enough relationship with us that she could be vulnerable a few months later and call us and say, by the way, this may be a crazy request. Do you have a couple $1,000 to give me? I've got an apartment, but I don't have the deposit, and I don't have the first month's rent. And, you know, we were blessed to be able to say yes. But it all happened because somebody took the time at the table to build relationship, and that, in that awkwardness.
Well, yeah, when there was one time when there were kids, and then they put games on the table, and once you got kids, so there was like an icebreaker.
Yeah, lots of good ideas, yeah.
That worked really
mm-hmm.
well.
Well, what was interesting when we did the shelter, the people had been together when they got to St. Bart's for maybe 6 weeks. The group had sort of, there were a few that had left or come back in,
mm-hmm.
new ones, but the core was there. And so the kids, this mom had three kids, one of the homeless people was a teacher. And so that man was teaching the children,
mm-hmm.
and then somebody else was something else, and they interlocked.
Mm-hmm.
They had the community together in this group because they had spent time. And it was quite a message to us who were working with them,
mm-hmm.
that they had figured out how to connect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I knew someone at my last church during the rotational shelter where she would make a connection with somebody and invite them to stay at her house until they got back on their feet. And she had a guest room. You know, these folks have social workers and all that good stuff, so it's not, you know, it's a risk,
mm-hmm.
but it's manageable, right? And of course, Maria and her witness shared how she got a call from the shelter saying, we have a single mom who is on the waiting list. Could you put her up for a few weeks or months? And she said, yeah. Because, you know, she now has a place, and so she wanted to pay that forward. So how deep, how far into the hole can we get, you know? Can
mm-hmm.
we go beyond just an hour of meal together? Maybe we go even further in relationship, you know? So. So that, I think that's the challenge. I think it's on us as the church to sort of cast that vision, provide opportunities, and encourage people to try that. Try that type of work. You can do it with your neighbor, probably, right? You can probably think of someone in your neighborhood.
Well, not my
neighborhood. Or your building.
No.
No? Or at work?
Yeah, no.
Oh, well. All right, you guys. Well, this is very helpful.
Sheltered
thank you
life.
For this.
Great. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.